Australian opera, Rita Hunter. Let's hear it for Rita. She is fabulous. Do we have any, are there any opera fans in today? Yes. Oh, good, good. Mike Williams told me the other night he really enjoyed an operetta the other night. I found out later it was a telephone operetta. This dramatic soprano, Rita Hunter. She first came to Australia in 1978 and later made the company in Australia her base. Currently she's appearing as Brunhilde in Wagner's Die Walküre. Would you welcome her to the Mike Wall Show, Rita Hunter? Should be Wagner, shouldn't I?
Yes.
Wagner.
Did I do fairly well?
Yes. Yes. For a talk show host, I did fairly well. It's Wagner's Die Walküre?
Die Walküre.
Die Walküre.
You want to be very Germanic, yes.
Yes. And do you sing it in German?
Yes, yes.
Does that mean that you actually acquire a lot of knowledge of other languages, or do you just learn the score?
Well, ideally one should learn to speak the languages, but sometimes you find that the singers only actually have enough time to learn to sing the Italian role or sing the German role.
Right.
They don't have enough time to learn the language as such. I remember when I first went to Germany, I decided that my back aches quite a lot because I'm a large lady, you see. I thought, I'm not going to spend the rest of my life in German standing up. So I found out how to ask for a stool in German. I thought, that's it.
That's exactly.
Food and drink you can grab off the shelf, but you have to ask a little man in German, haben Sie einen Stuhl bitte? So I thought, I'm all right, I've got something to sit on.
What is it, in case we all need this very important phrase in Germany?
Have you got a stool, please?
What is it?
Haben Sie einen Stuhl bitte?
Haben Sie einen Stuhl bitte?
Haben Sie.
Haben Sie.
Yes.
Einen Stuhl bitte?
Stuhl.
Well, that'll get me through Germany. No worries at all. Say it to a stranger and they'd look very...
They would, yes.
Is your interest only in serious music?
No, not at all. I do sing lots of lighter songs when I do recitals. Ivan Novello, Noel Coward.
Right.
And for listening to at home, I mean, obviously my daughter likes opera, but we also have to sit through the Beatles and whatever.
Yeah.
So she's got a very sort of wide taste.
Right.
But I like Scott Joplin, love it.
Do you? Yeah.
Yes, I do, yes. And I've been known to do strange things like come to the cabaret, to recitals, which a lot of the fans like, but some of the fans seem to think that, you know, because you sing such what I call terribly po-faced music, that you shouldn't let your hair down. You're
right.
Letting yourself down, you see. But sometimes you have to work out at the end of a recital. The recitals I usually do, I sort of chat in between the songs because, you know, you can get to know the audience, and then at the end you sort of say to your pianist, okay, it's okay for cabaret tonight, you know. You won't offend them, you see.
Right. They're cool audience.
They're cool,
let's
yes,
do cabaret.
Yes.
I believe Ragtime Cowboy Joe is one of your numbers.
That's right, yes, yes, I've done that. Yes, did that on the Russell Harty show in England, yes.
Did you?
Mm.
Would you like to do it on the Mike Wells show?
Down in Arizona where the bad men are, the only thing to guide you is an evening star. Like that.
in your current opera, as Brunhilde.
That's right, yeah.
You have a famous battle cry to do, don't
yes,
you?
Yes, yes. Every time she appears, she sings this and frightens everybody away.
She's a daunting dame, isn't
yeah,
she?
Yeah, she is rather, yes.
Your career started at what, about 15 or 16, I believe?
My professional career, 15,
yeah.
yes,
yeah.
As a principal boy in pantomime. And I believe there's photographs of it somewhere.
I think we have one here, yes. This is Rita in panto.
The legs are still all right, you see.
The legs are still all right.
Up to there.
Up to there, yes. And how did you get that job?
I'd been, from the age of eight, I'd been sort of in amateur theatricals, and I went to audition for this particular job, and I was given, tipped the wink by my dancing teacher that you won't get in if you tell them you're 15, you have to tell them you're older, so I said I'm 17. So I told a lie. Right at the beginning of my career was a
lie.
Right. See? But I got the job, so what the hell, you know.
What, as a kid, though, did you have music lessons?
Yeah. Had dancing lessons, had sort of singing lessons. Piano lessons, which were a shilling an hour.
Right.
very good they were. You know, after about six lessons, I think the teacher said, because I used to play by ear, still do, and the teacher said to my father, she's wasting my time and your money, forget it. You know, she'll always play by ear. Because I used to stumble through all the things, you know, watching the music. And she'd go out to make a cup of tea, and I thought, right, she's gone. And in my innocence, I thought she didn't know the difference, you see, but of course she did.
She did, yeah.
Yes.
That's funny, you know, I learned piano for about 10 or 12 years. I did first year MSA, in fact.
Yes.
But I never had the ability to play by ear, and that's why I gave up playing the piano. So we should get together.
We should get together.
You know, I always
yes.
thought, and I've never mastered this instrument. I've always got to look at those damn notes.
It's all improvisation.
Yes, well, that's wonderful if you can do that. you played the clubs in England too.
Oh yes, yes. I played the clubs basically to to get money for my lessons, because my dad earned about £9 a week, which is, what, $18, $19?
Yeah.
And I honestly don't know how they afforded the all the lessons that they gave me. Yeah. I even had elocution lessons and things like this, you know.
With grand opera, when something goes wrong, it must be on a grand scale. I mean, it's not an art form you can ad lib in, is it?
Oh, I don't know. Sometimes you have to. Like when the our gentleman friend blew the smoke at the Colosseum.
Oh, Mel Tennant, yes.
And yes, got a bit enthusiastic, and there was so much smoke we couldn't see the conductor.
He disappeared.
We disappeared, yes. Yeah. But lots of funny things happened. I remember in New Orleans, the producer wanted the baritone to come on a horse. And the horse was a beautiful black mare, and she was absolutely marvellous, and behaved herself until the baritone started to sing. And then it had diarrhoea everywhere. Absolutely everywhere. And
was the horse a music critic?
Obviously. And well, this was a dress rehearsal, but you have to understand that the dress rehearsals, they're almost the same here now, but they're called guild dress rehearsals.
Right, you've got an audience.
Terribly, frightfully people who are like that, you know, who pay for their ticket and they want a performance, you see, but eventually this thing just ground to a halt because I tried to keep on doing what I should do, which was walk forward and say, "Hail Nabucco," or whatever, and the producer just jumped out of the stall and says, "For Christ's sake, don't move, look what's on the stage," you know, which I would have had to walk through, you see. And eventually he said, "Somebody get a shovel, somebody get a shovel," and this little coloured guy came around the corner of the proscenium and said, "Ah, sorry, boss, we ain't got no shovel."
What a shame, someone's garden missed out on an absolute treat.
Eventually he came on with a little dustpan and brush. You never thought you'd brush it down. It was totally inadequate for what was there. I mean, in the end, I mean, we just all stopped, they brought the curtain down and then, you know, shoveled it all up. But the other time I had a problem with an animal was in Trovatore in Act 4 in the north of England. And they're prone to having theatre cats, these places, you
right,
see.
Right.
And I was aware when I was singing that, you know, I was singing this wonderful aria up to the heavens, you know. And I thought, there's something going across my vision, and being terribly nosy, I had to see. And I looked, and it was a great big ginger cat who'd walked straight across the stage, parked itself on my train, lifted its leg up and licked its bum all the way through the aria. And it was so rotten lazy that it didn't even move when I went to walk off. It got dragged off on the train.
Still licking its bum.
Still licking its bum.
Do you think people took much notice of you? No.
No, well, I just said to myself, another critic, you know.
You mentioned your daughter being in Australia with you, Rita, and your husband, of course, is
That's
here
right,
with you too.
Yes.
How did you meet him?
I met
Through
my
opera?
Husband, yes. I'd been in the Sadler's Wells Opera Company for 2 years as a chorister, and I left to join the Carl Rosa in the hopes that I would get some small parts in a smaller company.
Right.
And we both joined on the same day. You know, new people all sort of cling together.
Yes, right, against the common
that's
enemy.
It.
Yeah.
Yes. So that's where I met my husband.
Right, and he's a singer, obviously.
Yes, he's a tenor, yes. He doesn't sing professionally now, he teaches. Mm. Doesn't teach so much here as he does has done in England. He has to, you know, keep me in order, and I reckon that's enough for him, poor soul.
It sure is, yeah. Well, one career in a family, especially one
that's
like
right.
yours, is quite demanding.
That's right, yes.
Joan Sutherland is a pretty good mate of yours too, isn't she?
Yes, she's a marvellous woman.
What,
yes.
Do you sort of pop around and swap recipes and things?
Sometimes. Yeah. She lent me her house in New York once when we were there for about 6 or 7 weeks, rent-free, which was absolutely marvellous. And she once invited us up to her beach house at Palm Beach for a sort of a barbecue and a swim. And we had the meal, and she said, "You're going for a swim in the pool?" I said, "Well, I don't swim." And she said, "Oh, you don't have to swim to go in a pool." So I said, "Well, I haven't got a swimsuit." She said, "Oh, I've got an old one of mine that'll fit." I thought, "Oh, God, you know." And the thing was that I could not get it on alone, and it ended up with Joan on one side and my husband on the other, sort of heaving this thing. Richard Wadding said it's the funniest thing he'd ever seen in his life.
Quite simply.
I mean, I did go in the pool and...
and you floated quite well.
Yeah, Richard and I had a photograph taken together, which we've both decided we will not publish until we both retire.
Now, you've got a song for us today, which I'm delighted you're going to perform.
Yes.
How do you feel about singing? I know an awful lot of our regular singers occasionally say to me, "Oh, it's very hard to sing at this time of day." How do you find singing at this time of day?
Well, I've... It's a bit difficult at the moment because having sung Valkyra last night, which began at 6 o'clock and ended at 11:30, you know.
Wow.
So getting up this morning to have all this done was a bit of an effort.
Well, but I'm glad you made the
effort. Yes,
listen, we'll take a commercial break. We'll be back with you to catch up with your song. Okay. Rita Hutter, ladies and gentlemen. Rita Hutter sings One Kiss. Give her a big welcome.
In this year of 1792, our conventions have been thrown all askew, and I know I'm out of date when I seek one mate, one faithful lover true. To be really in the fashion today, you must have a dozen beaux in your sway. But somehow I don't believe in the modern plan. I want to wait for just one man. It's more fun to kiss a lover, short and tall. I have another spin. It's my only dream. One kiss, one man to save it for.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being with us today. Thank you, Rita. Rita is currently singing, as we said before, in the Australian Opera Company's production of Die Walküre at the Sydney Opera House.